Namaste. I have great pleasure in welcoming you all to this session. This year, Kalakshetra has the unique privilege of celebrating Constitution Day with a talk session by Honorable Justice Shri D.Y. Chandrachud, sitting judge of the Supreme Court, who has most kindly agreed to elucidate and give insights on the topic, Visualizing the Constitution Through Artistic Prisms, Stories of Aspiration and Emancipation. We will now begin with a prayer by the students of Kalakshetra Foundation, sung by Karthik, Sharat Kumar, and Amrita Varshini.
Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Buddha Gita, 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 Nikila Mata Vana Nirata Nata Jana Sugita, 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 Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Buddha Gita, Nikila Mata Vana Nirata Nata Jana Sugita, Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Jayati Jayati Jayati. Sakala Jiva Samata, Sakala Jiva Samata, Sadhu Sadhu Vidita, 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 Akila Loka Pritita, Paramananda Samudita, Akila Loka Pritita, Paramananda Samudita, Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Buddha Gita, Nikila Mata Vana Nirata Nata Jana Sugita, Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Jayati Jayati Jayati. Aganit Gunashila Ati Dayala Bala, Aganit Gunashila Ati Dayala Bala, Prakatita Shubhajala Patita Prana Lola, Prakatita Shubhajala Patita Prana Lola, Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Buddha Gita, Nikila Mata Vana Nirata Nata Jana Sugita, Jayati Jayati Bharat Mata, Jayati Jayati Jayati.
We will be taking in a few questions at the end of this session, so we kindly request you to send in your questions. Now I request our director, Srimati Revati Ramachandran, to kindly welcome the gathering.
Namaskaram. Kalakshetra is most fortunate to have the revered Honorable Justice Sri Dr. D.Y. Chandraji, sitting judge of the Supreme Court, address the gathering of students, performers, connoisseurs of performing arts and fine arts, and students of law on the subject, visualizing the Constitution through artistic prisms, stories of aspiration and emancipation. We are most privileged to welcome the Honorable Justice, Sir, and I thank him profusely for giving us this most unique opportunity of hosting him in the celebrations of the Constitution Day of India at Kalakshetra. I welcome the Chairman of Kalakshetra Foundation, Sri S. Ramadurai, ex-CEO and MD of Tacta Consultancy Services. It was his impetus and his notion that empowering the youth with the right skills and knowledge can define the future of our country that has made today possible for us. 26th November was marked as the Constitution Day of India by our Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji, in the year 2015. It aims to bring awareness on the importance of the Indian Constitution and its architect, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar. It is also celebrated as National Law Day in India. Kalakshetra is hosting today's session as a celebration of the Constitution Day of India. Every organization has a culture which has been sustained over decades. This culture is derived from the philosophy of the founder, and it is this aspect that will carry the organization for posterity. Kalakshetra Foundation is an historic institution established in the year 1936 by legendary Srimati Rukmini Devi, a great thinker, visionary, social reformer, and artist par excellence. Framed by Srimati Rukmini Devi through an intuitive vision, Kalakshetra has in fact laid down the ground rules for the presentation of classical arts. Not only is it the essence of tradition, but it is also aesthetically Srimati Rukmini Devi, an innovator and a conservator put together. The work is monumental and has stayed relevant through time. Srimati Rukmini Devi taught it rudimentary to educate young people, not only train them to be a great artist, but also to train them to appreciate art and to be sensitive to humanity. In the words of our founder, quote, Kalakshetra is an institution not merely for the development of art. It exists in order that youth may be educated not to become artists alone, but to have the right attitude to life, the right attitude to art, in order that they may be of great service to our country. Kalakshetra Foundation is now functioning as an autonomous body under the Ministry of Culture, Government of India. It has been declared as an institution of national importance. I am most honored to welcome our esteemed speaker, Honorable Justice, our Chairman, Sri S. Ramadurai, Sir, the Governing Board, the Academic Committee, Gurus, alumni, the Principal, Faculty, staff and students of Rukmini Devi College of Fine Arts, artists, art students, connoisseurs of art, law students and other guests for today's webinar. Thank you. Namaskaram.
May I now request our Chairman, Sri S. Ramadurai, former CEO and MD Tata Consultancy Services, to kindly give the opening remarks and introduce our speaker.
Thank you and a very, very good morning to all of you. On behalf of all of us, I would like to extend a very, very warm welcome to Honorable Justice Sri Dhananjay Yashwant Chandrachur. It's an absolute honor for us to have him deliver a talk on the subject which was covered, namely visualizing the Constitution through artistic prisms, stories of aspiration and emancipation. Before I introduce our Honorable Justice Dhananjay Yashwant Chandrachur, being the COVID times, the way most of the institutions are functioning on a remote mode through the distance learning using technology, this is also one of those unique events where we are using technology to disseminate the talk, I would only urge all of us to observe wearing the mask whenever we are outside, observe the social distancing, and practice hygiene. Now the speaker, Honorable Justice Dhananjay Yashwant Chandrachud, is currently a judge of the Supreme Court of India. He is a former Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court and a former judge of the Bombay High Court. He studied law at Delhi University in 1982, at a time when few jobs were available to the young law graduates. He worked for a while as a junior advocate, assisting lawyers and judges, including some memorable briefings that he did for Fali Nariman. He then joined the LLM program at Harvard Law School. After graduating from Harvard, he first worked at the law firm of Sullivan and Cromwell. After that, he practiced law at the Supreme Court of India and Bombay High Court. He was designated as senior advocate by the Bombay High Court in June of 1998. From 1998, he was additional Solicitor General of India until his appointment as a judge. He became a judge at the Bombay High Court from 29th of March 2000 until his appointment as Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court. During this time, he was also a director of the Maharashtra Judicial Academy. He was Chief Justice of the Allahabad High Court from 31st of October 2013 until his appointment to the Supreme Court of India. Honorable Justice was appointed Judge of the Supreme Court of India on the 13th of May 2016. He continues to be a visiting professor of comparative constitution law at the University of Mumbai and Oklahoma University School of Law in the United States. He has delivered lectures at the Australian National University, Deakin University, Melbourne Law School, Harvard Law School, Yale Law School, William S. Richardson School of Law at the University of Hawaii, and the University of Witwatersrand, South Africa. As a judge of the Supreme Court, he has been on the highest number of constitutional benches, 5 judges or more, constituted to hear matters before the Indian Supreme Court. During his tenure at the Supreme Court, he has delivered judgments on Indian constitution law, comparative constitution law, human rights law, gender justice, public interest litigation, commercial law, and criminal law. Justice Dhananjaya has been speaker at conferences organized by bodies of the United Nations, including the United Nations High Commission on Human Rights, International Labour Organization, and the United Nations Environmental Programme, the World Bank, and the Asian Development Bank. His father, Yashwant Vishnu Chandrachud, was the longest serving Chief Justice of India, and his mother, Prabha, was a classical musician. After attending Cathedral and Jonan School, Mumbai and St. Columba School in Delhi, he graduated with honors in economics and mathematics from St. Stephen's College, New Delhi, in 1979. He then obtained his LLB degree from Delhi University in 1982, followed by an LLM degree from Harvard University in 1983. At Harvard, he studied on the prestigious INLAC scholarship and received the Joseph Beale Prize. He went on to receive his doctorate of juridical sciences from Harvard University in 1986. I would now request Honorable Justice Shri Dhananjay Yashwant Chandrachud to deliver his talk. Thank you so much for being with us, sir, and thank you for all the attendees to be present.
Namaskaram. Shri S. Ramadurai, Chairperson of Kalakshetra, Dr. Revati Ramachandran, the Director, distinguished members of the faculty, students, all attending guests this morning, including judges, and distinguished citizens. I'm really honored to speak at today's Constitution Day webinar organized by Kalakshetra Foundation. It is often assumed that only the legal fraternity would see meaning in celebrating the day on which our constitution was adopted, as distinct from Republic Day, when the constitution actually came into force and effect. This is far from the truth, as our legal systems are constituted by culture. Two very distinguished scholars, Austin Surratt and Jonathan Simon, while analyzing the role of cultural studies in legal interpretation, have noted that the process of attributing legal meaning is not unidirectional, starting from what is enacted by Parliament to what is laid down by the courts. Citizens, in their myriad social relationships, are consumers of culture. They also use cultural means to advance their aspirations for a shared life. Culture is a defining feature of identity. An interdisciplinary study of law and culture tells us how professors and judges construct the law in their narratives, how ordinary people think about justice, how personal choices are governed by the law, and how the law transforms it into a norm. Culture, and that's the beauty of culture, it introduces a subjective element in the law, thereby expanding its learning. With this thought in mind, I believe that there cannot be a better avenue to honor the crystallization of our founding commitments to a free and equal country than in Rukmini Devi Arundel's halls of Gandharva Vedic music and Bharatanatyam dance. She was no less than a revolutionary herself. I have heard several accounts about the serenity of the Chennai campus, and until I am fortunate enough to pay a visit, I will make do with my virtual presence today. When I received the invite from the Kalakshetra Foundation to celebrate Constitution Day or Law Day, I was thrilled at the thought that a cultural academy wishes to use its medium to celebrate the framing of the Constitution. The world of fine arts, an avenue for entertainment, and a break from the banality of day-to-day life is also a minefield for progressive thought and action. I grew up in a family, in a household of lawyers, yet my first inspiration to pursue law was built of my first childhood love, a love of literature. I resonate with Charles W. Eliot when he said that books are the quietest of friends, wisest of counselors, and most patient of teachers. Through the vicarious world of books, I have experienced the dangers of fascism and anti-Semitism with Anne Frank in Nazi Germany, traversed through apartheid-ridden South Africa with Stephen Kumalo in the beautiful book by Alan Paton called Cry the Beloved Country. As a child, I almost had the entire book by heart, and shared the intersecting indignities faced by a black queer woman, Sally, living in a southern state of the United States of America. As a child, my life was shaped. I belonged to a middle-class family and my parents couldn't afford the cost of international travel. But I learned what I had to learn from the world of books and from the home. When I read Somerset's Maugham's A Moon and Sixpence, it was based partly on the life of a French painter who left Europe and his family for Tahiti. Then came The Good Earth by Pearl S. Buck, which dramatized life in a Chinese village in the 20th century. The Lust for Life, a biographical novel on Vincent van Gogh by Irving Stone. The Old Man and the Sea, Ernest Hemingway's story based in Cayo Blanco in Cuba, who struggles with a giant marlin off the coast. Over this pandemic, I've spent the last 8 or 9 months, apart from being in the virtual court, reading about 15 books. And one great sorrow which I have is that I'll be reading Priscilla Janas fighting for Mandela only after she passed away a couple of days ago. I was reading her obituary in the New York Times last night. After almost two decades at the bar and another two on the bench, I believe that these stories indelibly transform my worldview and have had the most profound impact on my life much before the study of law. My mother, as Mr. Ramadurai just mentioned, Prabha, was a disciple of Gana Saraswati Kishori Amonkarji, and my heart and mind and soul still resonates with the tunes of her Yaman or Bageshri. Even today, my heart is moved to tears when I listen to the Nirguni Bhajan by Pandit Kumar Gandharva. My favorites are Jo Baze Hari Ko Sada by Pandit Bhimsen Joshi and Pandit Jasraj singing Om Namo Bhagavati Vasudevaya is an eternal favorite. Very often in the night when my wife is listening to Netflix with her earphones, I go on to my own earphones and listen to some of these beautiful songs. The maestro with the violin, L. Subramanyam, is a personal favorite. But I'm fond of Western music as well. So my favorites include Hotel California by the Eagles, Mark Knopfler on his guitar, and I shouldn't forget mentioning Don McLean's Starry, Starry Night, the song which is titled Vincent. Today, in honoring the framing of our constitutive document, I do not intend to assume the role of an academic or a professor to analyze the scope of constitutional freedoms and protections that guarantee free speech, particularly Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution. There are excellent sources that have jurisprudentially analyzed the role of artistic expression and may effectively serve that curiosity better than the short while that I will be addressing you today. I will instead attempt today to locate the role of art in recent Indian and global history as not just a cultural facet of human life, but a fundamentally transformative medium for holding up a mirror to society. Artists, irrespective of the nature of their medium, are the most vibrant thought leaders in our society. And Kalakshetra is really a symbol of this vibrant medium that art provides. They foster engagement and debate at scales that are much higher than academic or political discourse. In my opinion, an artist's work is the closest human beings have been to achieve immortality. Let me share with you a slide of Vincent van Gogh's magnum opus, The Starry Night. Valued at almost nothing in his lifetime, and currently one of the world's priceless pieces of art, which is being studied by medical researchers to understand psychosis. Or Sylvia Plath's semi-autobiographical work, The Bell Jar, which is my next slide, preceded the second wave of feminism in the United States of America by over a decade. By its critical reflections on the cultural and social norms that defined and subjugated women, Shakespeare, renowned as the world's greatest playwright, writing in the 17th century, is now also a subject of colonial studies. His play, The Tempest, is used to discern perception of the white man's burden, which marginalized the natives, Caliban and Sycorax in his case, as barbarians with no legitimate claim to their land. Art, politics, and the law share a symbiotic relationship in any meaningful society that prides individual freedom and dignity. Today's books, cinema, museums, art galleries, theaters, songs, Nukkad Natak, and even a grandparent narrating stories are all vectors of our civilization's history that simultaneously lay the seeds for our future. Speaking of grandchildren, I've just taken a rain check with my little 2-year-old grandchild, who I couldn't talk to on the video because I was giving finishing touches to my presentation this morning. Often, there have been unfortunate times the world over when artistic expression can be policed and curbed by the excesses of the law. The Constitution of India was forged as a bulwark against censorship and subjugation that pervaded British India. Its freedoms and state duties were meant to serve as an antidote to majoritarian tendencies that seek to silence what they cannot digest. Our freedom struggle was set in incremental victories that were achieved by a mass mobilization and consequent deliberations with the British administration. Several Government of India Acts were promulgated with a view to devolve further power to Indians until the final Indian Independence Act of 1947. Sadat Hasan Manto, one of the finest of Urdu writers, wrote a famous story titled The New Constitution or Naya Kanoon, where his protagonist, Ustad Mango, was a tonga driver in the year 1935. Frustrated with the precarity and communal violence that had been perpetrated by British imperialist policies, Mango was elated after he heard of the Government of India Act, the new constitution, the Naya Kanoon, which promised self-rule and greater powers to Indians. Ustad Mango assumed that this Naya Kanoon, which translates to new law, would mean liberation of all Indians. However, the story ends with Ustad Mango being dragged away by the British police because while he had assumed that this Naya Kanoon would mean liberation from all of the colonial state's oppressive practices, including its brutal police powers and economic exploitation, it did little to change the status quo. What a powerful depiction in this piece of art. The British Raj never recognized Indians as citizens who could stake a legitimate claim against their administration. Therefore, they went to various lengths to clamp down on all forms of free speech and artistic expression. This was considered necessary in order to sustain their economic domination over the Indian subcontinent. Oppressive legislation such as the Vernacular Press Act of 1878 would preemptively confiscate the machineries of Indian language newspapers that attempted to even loosely criticize the Raj. Even outside the seemingly political sphere of life, artists were forced to adapt to Western tastes in order to retain their patronage. The Swadeshi movement was therefore popularized with the effort of Indian artists who sought to revive folk traditions as a way of creating a shared cultural identity. Abanindranath Tagore, 1871 to 1951 was his lifetime, founded the Bengal School of Art for reviving traditional forms of painting. Nandalal Bose was tasked with painting frescoes for the first Indian National Congress meeting in 1936 and the exhibition at Haripura Congress that could convey the aspirational message of Purna Swaraj, complete independence, through powerful images. That's a little slide which you have there. Contemporaneously, across the globe, art was evoked as the most powerful weapon to mold the collective conscience to validate the Universal Declaration of Human Rights in 1948 that enshrined norms of state sovereignty, life, liberty, and equality. Subversive art, such as the multilingual plaque reading Never Again at the Dachau concentration camp in Germany, which you have on the screen, infiltrated sites of the most gruesome oppression. They were a reminder to the world that some questions of human worth will never be up for debate again. The atomic bomb dome at Hiroshima is a stark reminder of the tragedies of war. When we think about our constitution and the freedom struggle that predated it, several events conjure up the mind. Perhaps some of the prominent ones being that of Mahatma Gandhi marching to Dandi, Pandit Nehru addressing the Indian Parliament with his tryst with destiny, Bal Gangadhar Tilak coining the effervescent phrase, Swarajya ha maza janma siddha adhikar ahe ani to mala mihelats, which meant Swaraj is my birthright and I shall have it, or Bankim Chandra Chatterjee's Vande Mataram that sought to unify the country. Critical theory, particularly from the feminist and subaltern lens, has begun probing these narratives to discover several marginalized voices that were equal forces in the fight for Indian independence, such as the working class revolts against the feudalistic Jotedar system, the working women's protest against the crippling land tax in the Bardoli Satyagraha, and the tribal movements in Santhal Batidar that were resisting the forceful usurpation of their lands and livelihood. Uncovering marginalized narratives in history requires a critical effort at dissecting lives and interpersonal relations. One of the most important subjects for such an analysis has been cultural representations. What they omit becomes almost as important as what they put in. Many of you may not know, but the original copy of our constitution, which was handwritten by Prem Bihari Narayan Raizada, actually contained beautiful paintings. The beginning of every part or chapter of the constitution was adorned by paintings created by the artists of Shantiniketan's Kalabhavan under the guidance of Nandalal Bose. These paintings were all in different styles, which were prevalent across India, including the wall paintings of Ajanta, the book illustrations of Rajasthan, the Mughal and Deccani traditions, the sculptures of Konark, Amravati, and the Chola South. They depicted the history of our nation right from the Harappan civilization until our independence from British rule. Similar to this, the halls of our parliament too are adorned by many murals which were commissioned right after our independence. The purpose of these was to capture the rich history of the nation, which could then be used to unify its constituents. These murals depict many important historical events ranging from the court of Akbar to Mahatma Gandhi's march to Dandi. However, while the beauty and artistry of these paintings and murals have almost universally been acknowledged, they have come under some criticism as well. The first of these criticisms has been about the choice. For instance, out of 43 artists who were commissioned to paint the murals, only 2 were women. A second criticism was the selection of historical events which were considered for consecration through these paintings and murals. Now, I must acknowledge that a country like India, which has a rich history, which is impossible to capture in its entirety for anyone, is susceptible to this kind of criticism of not including everything when you show something. However, the criticism is focused on the lack of representation of common Indians or the lack of subaltern voices and experiences in these paintings and murals. They tell the tale of India through its heroes who have come to dominate popular narratives while leaving out the stories of its common people. All this said, it is important to remember that the Indian Constitution presented a marked shift of the people's lives from subjects under British India to citizens of a free country. People tend to pass hasty comments on the length and the borrowed nature of the Constitution to undermine its potential. However, It would be wrong for us to assume that nothing has changed after independence. Just because we have retained some of the administrative structures of the British and several frameworks for governance that were established by the preceding acts. The commitments to individual freedom and dignity, transcending divisions of class, caste, gender, religion, and language were engineered through the Constitution. After its promulgation, it became a state project to imbibe the Constitution's values and norms through school textbooks, pamphlets, public exhibition, and documentaries. Legal historians and political scientists have complained that not much attention was devoted to post-colonial India, and their efforts have been stymied by poor record keeping. In these gaps, and even otherwise, art has served as the emotional murals of our citizenry who are living in their brave new world. Vikram Seth's A Suitable Boy, in his fictional narrative of India in 1951-52, explored the complex realities of land distribution, class inequalities, and communalism. Popular cinema caricatured the masses through a social and political analysis of a spectator negotiating the country's past and present. Raj Kapoor singing, Mera Juta Hai Japani, Ye Patloon Inglistani, Sar Pe Lal Topi Rusi, Phir Bhi Dil Hai Hindustani. As he migrated from a village in Mumbai, from a village to Mumbai in Bollywood, in a movie of 1955, became a national hymn that continues to evoke strong emotions. His infectious optimism for the future of our free country was emblematic of the times as citizens navigated their relationship with an autochthonous state. The nomadic communities of Kankali Bhat or Putli Bhat in Gujarat and Rajasthan have been using their craft of katputlis, wooden puppets from the 13th century. These skilled craftspersons use the dexterity of their fingers to entertain audiences using sleek narrative, humor, and music. Upon independence, these folk legends were used by the state to communicate state messages of family planning, education, and health to far-flung eras. One can argue that integration of art into the mainstream is predicated on its conformity with the dominant political consciousness at the time. While this may be largely true, the unique nature of artistic expression is such that it cannot be monopolized. Therefore, art from the fringes challenges society to reckon with its shortcomings and birth counter discourse against oppressive manifestations of power and authority. Even in times of constitutional crisis, such as the emergency, the resilience and creativity of artists, in spite of being subject to pre-censorship and preventive detention, would illuminate our lives like light entering through the cracks. One such profound, though tongue-in-cheek example was this obituary, which was published in the Times of India, which nobody would have assumed would ever contain a political message. The obituary got past the censor's black pen soon after the emergency was declared in 1975. And it wittily read, Deocracy-DEM, meaning democracy. Beloved husband of T, full stop, Ruth, standing for truth. Loving father of L.I. Bertie, standing for liberty, brother of faith, hope, justicia, expired on June 26, 1975. I was a young child when my father was sitting next to me in Mumbai at a relative's house when he opened this and read it and explained to me the import of this, and it's never left my mind. Therefore, art in times of relative stability and also in times of crisis serves as a constant reminder of our founding commitments by bringing constitutional principles to life. Mahesh Eklundswar, the prominent Marathi playwright, wrote a play called Party, which was subsequently made into an eponymous movie by Govind Nihalani as part of what many called Bollywood's parallel cinema. Both the play and the movie posed a central question to its viewers in the form of a discussion between the elites of a city attending a party. The question was, what is the value of art which does not challenge the political status quo of the day? It challenges people to ask themselves whether art would have any meaning to it if it was not being used to question the injustice around them and in helping uplift people. While all of us today will be left pondering on this question, we all cannot deny the powerful potential of art when it is used as a form of political contestation. In talking about such art, one cannot help but begin by acknowledging the brilliant Dalit art forms, which originated often due to the oppression faced by their communities. The father of the Indian Constitution, Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, envisaged that the document would provide the necessary breaking ground for ensuring the abolishing of untouchability and the equal status for Dalit communities. This vision is reflected in Articles 14, 15, 16, and 17 of the Constitution. However, I believe that while the Constitution does provide the Dalit communities with a legal basis for equality of opportunity and dignity within India, it does not take away from the oppression which was faced by them for years and which is reflected in their art. An example of this is the Mithila paintings, where women from the Mithila region of Bihar created their own form of the painting style native to that region, which was often practiced by the upper caste women. Within this, the Godna art became particularly popular. This art form was based upon the Godna tattoos, which were often created by Dalit women, which were in themselves a form of a revolt against the upper caste norms, which forced these women to only wear jewelry of inferior metal. These paintings are created using colors made from mixing natural substances like cow dung with leaves, flowers and vegetables, and depict the daily lives of these Dalit women. Similarly, a new genre of art, colloquially named as protest art, has been popularized, where one's art form becomes their means of protest, not just against entrenched political structures, but even its dominant manifestations in art. Examples of protest art include street art and graffiti, which became a popular form of protest during the Arab Spring in countries like Egypt, which challenged their oppressive regimes. Guerrilla Girls, a feminist collective operating in New York, challenged the prevalent sexism and racism of the world of art through their posters. Their rebellion against museums, which may often represent the sensibilities of entrenched dominant consciousness, went a huge way in ensuring that these sites of heritage begin to interrogate the power structures they unwittingly perpetuate. Resistance against social and cultural capital even birthed new styles of art, such as hip-hop dance, which emerged as a counter-cultural movement against the ghettoization of African Americans. Closer home, art has served as an important tool for the preservation of a national collective memory. Scholars have argued that every nation goes through the process of nation building, where the events of its past are used to form a collective conscience, which can bind together all the varied identities. Our Constitution aspires to be such a document, which can provide common ground on which the identity of independent India could be forged. While I do believe our Constitution has been successful in building a collective nation, it is rather the individual community's art which has preserved their place in our nation's collective memory. Art brings the stories and experiences of the marginalized groups to the forefront, while empowering the communities to find a voice through this artistic expression. The first example which comes to my mind here is Dancing Queens, which is India's first transgender dancing troupe. The troupe has been performing for nearly 17 years now, and their shows often depict the stories of ordinary trans women while touching upon themes like growing up different, discovering one's sexuality, and facing difficulties like begging and prostitution. Their shows serve a dual purpose of providing a platform to transgender individuals for their artistic expression and also allowing the viewers to experience their story. So this is the popular connect with the judgment of the Supreme Court in Nalsa. Cinema is another medium through which the stories of marginalization and oppression often come to the forefront. In this context, the Marathi film Fundri is a prominent example. It tells the story of a young boy belonging to an untouchable community, trying to integrate himself into a caste-ridden society, which is entirely unwilling to accept him. What is particularly moving about the films is its ending, which is not happily ever after, much like the lived realities of many Dalits. It ends with our young protagonist coming to realize his untouchability and his anger over it. He tries to give action to that anger by throwing a stone at the screen, consciously aimed even at the viewer. This forces the viewer to introspect upon their own lives. Another film which comes to my mind is the Tamil film Asuran, directed by Vetrimaran. It tells the story of a Dalit family facing oppression from their upper caste landlord who seeks to take away their land. Not unlike Fundri in Marathi, the film ends with our protagonist's family defeated on account of caste-based victimization. The father of the family, about to be sent to jail, poignantly tells his son to not run after land which can be taken away from them, but after education, which will always be their own. Art can also be used to acknowledge the history of oppression, often as a reminder of what has happened and why it must not be repeated in India. It forces us as a nation and as a community to not only acknowledge the horrors of what has come before, but also to develop empathy for those who have suffered during them. In this vein, Rohinton Mysteries, A Fine Balance, highlights the emergency era policies, which were prominent factors that affected its characters' lives in Mumbai. Another such project is the Partition Museum, which serves as a repository of the lived experiences of many whose lives changed overnight when India and Pakistan partitioned after our independence. Globally, it is in this spirit that Marjane Satrapi created Persepolis, which was a graphic novel depicting her experiences as a young girl growing up in Iran and Austria during the Islamic Revolution. The beauty of the graphic novel lies not only in its ability to tell the story of a nation affected by a revolution, but also keeping the reader engaged with its honest understanding of what it means to be a female child growing up in such a tumultuous time. Such acknowledgement can often also be symbolic, as one can see from the architectural choices of the Constitutional Court of South Africa. You have it on the right side of your screen. The hall which houses the main court was created using the bricks from the awaiting trial block of their jail, where Mahatma Gandhi was also lodged. This was done almost as a reminder of the nature of the apartheid regime that affected South Africa prior to the formation of its constitutional court and the duty of the court to ensure that this history was never repeated. A very poignant instance is that from the constitutional court, you can see the feet of people. And the idea of allowing the feet of people to be seen by the judges was to remind them every day of their working lives that you are intended to be of service at the feet of the people of South Africa. When considering art, especially public art, we must remember that one of the most fundamental disputes will often be about what art do we choose to put at the forefront and at what opportunity cost. This contestation over public space is a widely acknowledged phenomenon across the globe. Hence, in a country as diverse as India, it is inevitable that not all art has been provided a meaningful space. To counter this, many of the artists from traditionally marginalized communities have taken to the streets. The prime example of this in my mind are the numerous pride parades which happen all across the country. There you have the pride parades. These parades serve as a safe space for members of the community to celebrate their sexuality and gender. Even more so, it allows the members of the LGBTQ community to express themselves through some of the loveliest posters and clothes one can imagine. Another project I would like to mention is the Aravani Street Project, which is a Bengaluru-based collective. Its members are largely part of the transgender community and use their artistic lens to paint murals all across the city. These murals often depict scenes from their life and spread a message for equality for their community. This allows for their lived experience to see the light of the day and reach a wider audience. Finally, from my perspective as a member of the legal fraternity, I have also witnessed art being an instructive medium to acquaint citizens with the complexities of the judicial system. I fondly remember this one time when I was on the bench of the Bombay High Court and was surprised to notice Boman Irani, a popular Bollywood actor, attending my courtroom as a spectator. On inquiry, I was told that this was his endeavor to prepare for a role in a movie. It made me wonder how powerful popular art and cinema truly is by its ability to communicate complex ideas and legal principles in a satiable form. As judges, the adversarial process compels us to look at issues from a detached lens in order to retain our ability to uphold the rule of law. But art depicting the legal system then serves as a refreshing reminder of the lives that are impacted and humanizes the individuals who approach us with their problems. A foremost example of this for me is Chaitanya Tamhane's multilingual film, Court. The film, through its story, explores the trial of an activist poet charged for the abetment of suicide of a manual scavenger through his politically charged songs. The film not only draws attention to the realities of our justice system, but tries to highlight the lived experiences of all the individuals who are affected by the justicing administration. This includes not only our poet and the family of the manual scavenger, but also of the defense lawyer, the prosecutor, and even the judge presiding over the case. The film forces its viewer to acknowledge the human lives at stake in these disputes, rather than looking at them as mere precedents in the law. Another example which comes to my mind is the recent Bollywood film, Hitesh Kawalya's Shubhamangal Zyada Savdhan, which humorously and lovingly tells us the story of a father coming to terms with his son's homosexuality. Interestingly, the film is set in the backdrop of the Supreme Court's hearings challenging the constitutional validity of Section 377 of the Indian Penal Code. When the homosexual couple is about to be arrested by the police for a violation of Section 377, the father finally acknowledges his son's sexuality and requests the police to wait until the next morning when the verdict was due. And that was the verdict of the Supreme Court. The film ends with everyone, including the police, gathered around when we pronounce the judgment in Navtej Singh Johar versus the Union of India, which decriminalized homosexuality, and the police gladly leaving the couple alone as they celebrate with their family. I must confess, I had a lot of thoughts going on in my mind when I pronounced such an important judgment, but never did I imagine that my work would become the plot of a Bollywood film. To end my presentation this morning, let me briefly speak about a book which is quoted often whenever one wishes to describe a dictatorial dystopia. I'm of course talking about 1984 by George Orwell. While many of you may already be familiar with this, for those who are not, the book tells a story of a fictional nation which was ruled by a leader referred to only as the Big Brother. It is a story of an oppressive state seeking full control over every aspect of its citizens' lives through constant surveillance. While 1984 is always remembered for these aspects, many readers often skip its appendix altogether. Therein, Orwell describes the principles of newspeak, which was a language created by the Big Brother to replace colloquial English. Orwell hauntingly describes Big Brother's ultimate goal to replace all of English with newspeak, which severely limits an individual's vocabulary. It ultimately hopes to diminish their capability to dissent, since there will be no vocabulary to express it. As a part of this goal, the state even tries to rewrite all existing literature in newspeak. However, interestingly, the appendix ends by letting us know that this ultimate goal of Big Brother failed and led to his downfall. Newspeak failed because there were certain documents which it just could not translate. The example it offers us is the Declaration of Independence of the United States, in which they could not translate the concept of liberty and freedom that are essential to negotiating with one's government. It is my firm belief that the role language played in Orwell's dystopia is an analogy to the role that art plays in our lives. While forms of art contain their own aesthetic beauty, they also carry within them the history of our lives and communities. As such, the art being created within our nation often stores within itself the salient features of the Constitution. The art of today may be a window into our future tomorrow. It may challenge our worldview or even make us uncomfortable. But if history has taught us one thing, it is that preserving a genuine marketplace for ideas will always leave us for the better. Art forms that once envisaged sovereignty and self-rule for India were brutally suppressed due to their audacity to question the culture of authority during the British Raj. Therefore, when we suppress art, we suppress progress. To quote the European Agency for Fundamental Rights, there is a human right to create art, to admire it, critique it, challenge it, be provoked by it, respond to it, and to ignore it. Our Constitution is not merely a collection of words that lay out the rules of the nation's governance. It is also a document of aspiration and hope. It contains within itself a dream of a nation, united in its resolve to ensure the greatest of democratization, while preserving individual liberty and dignity at its very core. If we wish to live in the society that our Constitution envisaged for us, our progressive action would also demand collective duties to live by the principles that it holds in the highest regard. If Manto's Ustad Mango was to travel in time and live in our society as it is today, our collective endeavor must be towards averting those very feelings of dejection and betrayal that he felt against the Government of India Act 1935 and should never feel about today's Naya Kanun, which is the Constitution of India. I'm thankful to you for having invited me to make this presentation and for sharing some of my most deep and personal thoughts with you on this occasion. I'm grateful to Kalakshetra, and it's been a great honor to be here to not merely as a tribute to the Constitution Day, but as an honor to the memory of the founder of the institution, Rukmini Devi Arundel. Thank you. Namaste.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Excellent.
Thank you.
May I now request Sri Rohan Shah to conduct the question and answer session.
So, firstly, on behalf of everyone who's had this privilege, I just say a very big thank you. And to all of the audience, we've got just a little inkling of the width and brilliance of Dr. Chandrachud that all of us are very fortunate to see more recurrently in court. There are a few questions, four questions, that we would like to have your thoughts on. The first of these is from Chakravarti. And this asks, how can art be employed to nourish and strengthen the idea of secularism, which is being tested right now? And has secularism run its course?
Well, let me say this, that art, the beauty of art is that art is spontaneous. Everybody who writes something, whether it's a poem, whether you're painting something, of course, there are art forms which also require a great deal of discipline, because art itself has its own discipline, whether it's Bharatanatyam or any other dance form, there's an internal discipline about it. But I do believe that the importance of art lies in the fact that it has the ability within it to give expression to some of our most deep and profound beliefs and thoughts. And by creating the freedom to people to propagate art, to portray art, we are really in that sense strengthening some of the most fundamental values of the Constitution. Because the essence of art is to question. The essence of art is to move others. The idea of art is always whether you are moved to a tear or you're moved by feelings of love or you're moved by feelings of joy or deep sadness. The idea of art is always to make a transformation of the human spirit. And in making that transformation of the human spirit, we invite people to go beyond their immediate boundaries and to really reach out to some of the most profound values which the Constitution has enshrined. And in that sense, the one of the messages which I wanted to convey through my presentation today is the diversity of art. And the importance of the diversity of art is in recognizing that it portrays in that sense the diversity of the human spirit, not just within the country, but across the globe. The spirit of global humanity, of the element of a human nature, the essence of the essence of humanity that dwells in each one of us, which art really encourages to us to explore. And in promoting that sense of diversity, in promoting that sense of tolerance, in promoting that sense of pluralism, of inclusion, I do believe that art propagates and preserves each one of the values of our Constitution, including secularism itself, which is a respect for each other and for all our religious beliefs and for our right to believe as it is for our right not to believe as well. We accept and respect all ends of the spectrum in the Constitution.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
The freedom of speech, freedom of expression, freedom of choice are so integral to the fabric of art, the fabric of culture. And the Supreme Court has always been a champion of these thoughts and these rights. Some thoughts and comments from you on that.
Yes, I do believe that, you know, if you look at the history of the Supreme Court, and if you look at the Supreme Court in India and compare it with the Supreme Courts of various other of nations, including the US Supreme Court, the UK Supreme Court, the Constitutional Court of South Africa, you would find that, you know, the Supreme Court has been a very major fulcrum of bringing about a change in social thought. Now, I have said elsewhere that you cannot expect judgments of courts in and of themselves to bring about social change. because bringing about social change is a much broader national project, which depends not merely on judgments of the court or the manner in which the law is interpreted, but also in terms of how the citizens work the Constitution. And while at the same, while we emphasize the work of the Supreme Court, I think it is very important at the same time for us to realize the constraints, the restraints which operate on the judicial process, and to understand that all process of bringing about constitutional reform or social change is in that sense a bipartisan effort of the, on the part of the citizens and organs of government, including really prominently the judiciary. So while I do emphasize the vital role which is played by courts in the interpretation of the Constitution, I equally am sensitive to the notion that the Constitution is as good as the citizens who work that Constitution on. And therefore, we must emphasize the importance of social movements. And that, I believe, is the strength and the power of art, because it takes away this notion of, you know, a top-to-bottom approach and allows common citizens to find expression to their ideas, their views, their imagination of their quest for change through different art forms.
Another question. In the era of a ever-evolving new cultural tapestry with social media, with so many different new art forms, with so many different points of access, how do you see these influence us, and what sort of roles and responsibilities do you see for people who offer these platforms for so many to participate?
I think the first great impact which it has is just the enormity of the choice in terms of what technology has done to the availability of information, knowledge, including information through art forms. I mean, just a very simple example, I mean, of what the pandemic has done to us. Say 50 years ago or 30 years ago, if a pandemic like this had taken place where you had to maintain social distancing, you would have a complete disconnect with all forms of art, because art was in that sense congregational. What the pandemic and the change in technology has done is, I think, to decentralize and democratize art by ensuring that our public lives are not as congregational as they used to be. So each individual sitting in the confines of their home are able to connect with the rest of society. Now, having said that, we must also really understand that there's also a big digital divide in India, and there's a big technological divide. So just as, you know, the availability of new forms of portraying communication or conveying communication has opened up wide choices, my concern also is that these choices should not really be restricted by the availability of access to technology, because technology now is a very powerful communicator of ideas, whether it's the social media or whether it's a Bharatnatyam recital on YouTube or just any other lecture or art form. And therefore, I think that it's important that the access has to be equitably allocated. And that is something which not just the state, but civil society also needs to work on in a more value-neutral sense, because strengthening access to information, to knowledge, is crucial, to my mind, to make available the diverse forms of free expression which are available to a wider strata of society. Yes, of course, you have a flip side, because I mean, everybody here today is a citizen's journalist, you know, who can have the freedom to express what they want on the social media. But that's an age we are all going into. I mean, we're already in the middle of it. So I don't think there's any question of going back. The question is about how you ensure that this is as widely disseminated as possible, which particularly issues have thrown up in the pandemic, by the lack of access to education for a certain state of society, which doesn't have access to tablets or laptops or smartphones, so on and so forth.
As a last question, I've combined two questions from Sudhir Chandran and Megha Nair, and that's much more personal. They ask, how do you use music or art to unwind? And one is from a law student who says, what are your recommendations of the books we might read and the cinema that we might see for us to develop even something of the perspective you have?
You know, I must share this with you. That is, judges, we lead very public lives at a certain level, especially now on this on the virtual courtroom, because every moment of your working life as a judge in the court, you're constantly in public scrutiny, and your written word is also, of course, subject to public scrutiny. So, to my mind, my interface with art, or my engagement with art, allows me to sort of retreat back into the core of my being, so to speak. So when I listen to music, I leave everything aside, including perhaps my own being. And it's important that we also leave aside, you know, our person or all that you sort of accrue in terms of your ego, your knowledge and everything, and sort of keep that all aside and retreat into who you are essentially as a being. And I think music in particular has this unique ability to allow you to transcend your immediate and to sort of keep aside everything that has happened in your day and retreat into yourself and then and connect. It also helps you to calm yourself. I think as a judge, it's very important for us to be calm, to have a sense of compassion, to not be judgmental. We judge others constantly in the legal cases which come up before us. But it's equally important for judges not to be judgmental, to understand the way people lead their lives and allow them that freedom to lead their lives in the way which they think they should be leading. So, to answer your question, I think for me, music and reading are the two greatest sources of allowing me to look beyond my immediate work, which takes so much of one's time. And rarely does a day go by when I haven't spent, say, the last 1 hour or 1.5 hours without spending some time on reflection, on reading something very, very different from what is connected to law. And on the law student's question, I would suggest this, that, you know, tap your interests, see what you like to read. For instance, I love to read history, and I've been associated a lot with the evolution of the feminist movement. So I read a lot about the evolution of the feminist movement, both in terms of fictional literature as well as from contemporary accounts which are based on fact. So either way of the spectrum, I also love to read something on economics, which is what I studied at St. Stephen's College, and I haven't given up my love for reading on economics. And of course, law, which I do occasionally have to read apart from the day-to-day work. I read this beautiful biography of Sandra Day O'Connor called The First during the pandemic. And but speaking for myself, I like to read very diversely, because reading as broad a spectrum as you can imagine, and this is for the law student, allows you to keep your options open at your stage of life when you are just about setting up into a career. You must also have the ability to reason with yourself as to what you want to do. And by being exposed to diverse influences, whether it's in terms of travel or art or music or reading or friendships, it allows you to understand what really the true meaning of human life is. For instance, I have been deeply, deeply enriched by friends who belong to the LGBTQ community. So when I was writing the 377 judgment, I was able to understand in a more humane perspective, just because of the fact that my association with very good human beings who are close friends of mine enabled me to understand a perspective on what brings meaning to the lives of a very important segment of our society. So the idea of all forms of reading or your interface with art, language, music is to expose yourself to varying strands of thought, which enable you to also question your own upbringing, you know, to question some of the values which you have imbibed maybe from your profession. For instance, lawyers typically tend to be very, very conservative, you see, especially commercial lawyers. So it's very important that, you know, you allow, you give a certain degree of importance to your life as a lawyer, but then keep that aside and then try and evolve as a human being, which is very important for a judge as well, I think.
Thank you, sir. And, we would have loved to go on, but thank you for this whole interaction where I think we've been blessed not only to see one of the most empathetic and eminent jurists, but one of India's foremost thinkers. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rohan. Such a pleasure.
Thank you, Rohan, for a great session. Thank you, Rohan.
Thank you, Mr. Ramadurai. Thank you very much, Ma'am Repti Ramchandran.
Many comments. There are many comments of, which they have said that they've liked the whole program, and we'll be putting it on Facebook, and they can anyone can watch it later also, sir, for them.
Thank you very much. Bye. Thank you.
1 minute, sir. We have the vote of thanks.
Thank you, sir. Now, may I request our Deputy Director, Dr. Natarajan, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Pavitra. On this wonderful occasion, before taking my privilege to extend the vote of thanks, I recall the quote of Sir Frederick Pollock, an English jurist of 19th century, that is, the practice of law is a perfectly distinct art. It was indeed a great pleasure and privilege to take part in the audience to enjoy the dynamic lecture on visualizing the Constitution through artistic prisms, stories of aspirations and emancipation. We are glad to witness the appreciation of art by a great scholar of law, which started from classical Hindustani music, travels right from the insights on the works of Vincent van Gogh, extending through Western music, and further extends to the recent Tamil movie Asuran, connecting everything with the true sense of law and justice from several dimensions. After listening to the lecture of our Honorable Justice, we precisely understand it is no surprise that our Honorable Justice, being a scholar of law, chose to deliver such a thoughtful talk out of the box, as he has inherited both law and art in his genes. As you well said, sir, the discipline is fundamental principle of the true art. The history has obviously shown us the link between art and law from time to time. As we all see, have seen, the artists are ones who always come up first to protest against any injustice or inequality and become revolutionary mortals through their artworks. Our Mahakavi Bharati is one of the examples. In this precious moment, I thankfully remember the service of our founder, Srimati Rukmini Devi, herself a revolutionary artist who dedicated her entire life to bring back the true spirit of Bharatanatyam to the place which the wonderful art rightfully deserves. As we are nearing the concluding part of this webinar, I, on behalf of the chairman, director, staff and students community of Kalakshetra Foundation, express our sincere gratitude to Honorable Justice Sri Chandrachud sir, sitting judge of the Supreme Court of India. Thank you very much, sir. I wish to thank the mastermind behind all our efforts, our Honorable Chairman, sir, Sri S. Ramadurai. I wish to thank our Director, Madam Srimati Revati Ramachandran, for her guidance and encouragement. I extend my gratitude to Advocate Anju Arora for her vibrant coordination from the Office of the Honorable Justice. I further extend our gratitude to Sri Rohan Shah for conducting the QA session. I appreciate the enthusiasm in the audience in expressing their views and asking thoughtful questions. I am thankful to the entire law fraternity including the lawyers, scholars, and students of law who joined with us in the webinar. I'm also thankful to the entire Kulakshetra community, including the staff, students, and alumni for taking part in the webinar. I appreciate the outreach team of Kulakshetra Foundation who are hosting and coordinating this session. Shri Guhan from Rukmini Devi College of Fine Arts, Shri Sriranjini from our museum, Shri Manohar, our sound engineer, Shri Venkat Raman, Archives Coordinator, and Shri Vardhan Tiwari, Outreach Coordinator. Thank you all for joining with us.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Have a nice day.
Thank you, too. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now request all of you to arise for the national anthem.
Jana Gana Mana Adhinayaka Jayahe Bharata Bhagya Vidata Punjab Sindhu Gujarat Maratha Dravida Utkala Banga Vindhya Himachala Yamuna Ganga Uchala Jaladi Taranga Tava Shubha Nave Jage तव शुभ आशीष माहे गाहे तव जय जन गण मंगलदायक जय हे भारत भाग्य विदाता जय हे जय हे जय हे जय 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 हे
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.